Hello everyone. So today we will discuss why do soldiers break their march while they cross a bridge, and in doing so we will also try to understand simple harmonic motion, which is the theory behind this. So in 1850 there was a suspension bridge called Angers Bridge across River Maine in France. One night a battalion of 200 soldiers was marching on the bridge. Suddenly the bridge collapsed and all 200 soldiers died. Since that incident, no battalion marches when they move on a bridge. Now let's try to analyze this in detail. So the bridge is made up of small molecules. So when soldiers march on the bridge, the molecules of the bridge start to oscillate. So if you represent any one molecule of the bridge by this yellow dot, so when soldiers march on the bridge, this molecule will oscillate between the point A and B. Now we make the following observation from the motion of the particle. So number one, the particle oscillates in a straight line. Number two, at the extremes, the velocity of the particle is zero, right? Since at the extreme, the velocity of the particle is zero, hence the particle always accelerates towards its center. And lastly, the maximum distance the particle goes from the center is denoted by A in this diagram. So A is called the amplitude of oscillation. So as we can see, this is a type of oscillation in which the particle moves in a straight line. So this motion is called simple harmonic motion. Simple harmonic motion is a special type of oscillation in which the particle moves in a straight line. Now one more thing which is important to observe over here is that the particle repeats its motion after a particular time interval. So let's say the particle initially starts from origin O, it goes to complete one oscillation, it will go from O to A, then reach B, and then finally reach O. So let's say it completes one oscillation in time t, right? The second oscillation again it will complete, after time t. So the time t, this capital T, in which the particle completes one oscillation is called the time period of oscillation, right? Now this motion of the particle can be modeled using a mathematical equation. So let me write the mathematical equation and then I'll explain how I have modeled. So let's say this is the y direction. This is the y direction and this is the origin. So I can write y is equal to A sine omega t plus delta. So let's see how this equation satisfies all the observations which we have discussed. Now the sine function takes the value from minus 1 to plus 1. So we know that sine function is somewhat like this. Its value ranges from plus 1 to minus 1. So this equation, this y will have the maximum value as a and the minimum value as minus a. So this replicates the motion of the particle. The extreme positions of the particle are plus a and minus a respectively from the origin, right? The second thing to understand over here is that why we have chosen omega t plus delta. So why we have chosen omega? So we wanted to represent the motion, represent the motion of the particle as a function of time, right? But we define sine of an angle and time has unit of seconds. Hence we introduce one more term called omega, which will have the unit of omega will have the unit of radian per second, right? Radian per second. So omega t will have unit of radian. So that's why we write omega t. And we have chosen delta over here. We have chosen delta over here because the particle the initial position of the particle may not be the origin. The particle may start to oscillate from this position or even A. So delta is basically there to represent the initial position of the particle. Now if we differentiate this y with respect to time, we will get the velocity of the particle. So velocity will be differentiating y with respect to time, so we will get A omega cos omega t plus delta. So this is by property of differentiation. If we differentiate this velocity, then we will get acceleration, which will be y double dot, which will be minus A omega square sine omega t plus delta. Now you can see acceleration, we can see this negative sign over here. So as we had made our observation, acceleration is always towards center. So the acceleration is always in the negative direction to the direction of the motion of the particle. So this model again satisfies our observation. Now if we multiply this acceleration by m, we will get the force acting on the particle. So F force acting on the particle will be mass times acceleration will be minus m omega square a sine omega t plus delta. So this a sine omega t plus delta is nothing but y. So my force becomes minus m omega square y. And let me define this m omega square by a term called k, and let me call it force constant. Then my force becomes minus f is equal to minus ky. So just see this term, force acts in the direction opposite to the direction of oscillation. So force and acceleration have the same direction. So force also acts towards the center. Now m omega square will be equal to k, and omega will be equal to under root k by m. Now whatever we have discussed, I have summarized here. Now we know that the particle repeats its motion after the time period, which is capital T. So let's say at time t is equal to small t, the position of the particle is given by y is equal to a sine omega t plus delta. So at time t is equal to small t plus capital T, which is the time period, the position of the particle will be the same, right? So now if I further expand these to this term, then we get this equation. And we know that the sine function repeats its value after an interval of 2 pi, right? Now for these two equations to be same, this omega t has to be equal to 2 pi, because the sine function then only will repeat its value and we'll get the same value of y. If that happens, then omega becomes 2 pi by t. So here we quantify omega. Now let's define one more term called frequency of oscillation. So it is the number of oscillations made in 1 second. So if the time period of the particle is t, it means what? In time capital T, the particle makes one oscillation. So in 1 second, how many oscillations will it make? It will make 1 by t oscillation, which is the frequency. And from this equation, we can put the value of 1 by t over here, which will be omega by 2 pi. So frequency is equal to omega by 2 pi, and the unit of frequency is hertz. Now let's get back to answering our question where we all started. Why do soldiers break their march? So far what we have discussed is that when the particle oscillates, it oscillates freely without the influence of any external resistance. In that case, the particle will maintain its amplitude throughout and also its frequency. However, in real life, the particle faces resistance, and the resistance increases when the speed of the particle increases. Secondly, the resistance tries to decelerate the particle. So if we try to model resistance in our equation, we'll have to add a term minus b y naught, where b is the dampening constant or resistance constant, and y naught is the velocity. Now the particle which oscillates besides the resistance due to air could be under the influence of an external force also, which might affect its oscillation. So for example, when soldiers march on bridge, they march in a rhythmic pattern. They apply a force on the bridge which itself changes periodically with time. So if we factor into that force on the oscillation of the particle, then we'll have to further modify our equation by adding this term f naught sine omega ft. Now here sine omega ft represents the periodic nature of the march, of the soldier's march, and omega ft represents the frequency of their march. So this is our final equation, keeping into account both the effect of dampening and the external force. If we solve this differential equation, we get the solution in this form. The y will be equal to a sine omega ft plus phi. So what does this equation say? This equation says that in steady state, the particles of the bridge will oscillate at the frequency of at the same frequency at which the soldiers march on the bridge. Number one. Number two, the amplitude of oscillation of the particle of the bridge will be given by this equation. So the amplitude depends on omega f, which is the frequency at which the soldiers march, and omega, which is the natural frequency of the bridge, which is under root k by m, which we discussed earlier. Now if we plot a, the amplitude, with omega f, which is the frequency at which the soldiers march, we will get a graph like this. Now if the frequency at which the soldiers march, which is wf, becomes equal to this value, then the amplitude becomes very high, and this situation is called resonance. Further, if the effect of dampening is zero, then resonance will occur when the frequency at which the soldiers march become equal to the natural frequency of vibration, and in that case the amplitude will tend to infinity. So for small dampening at resonance, the amplitude of oscillation of the particle becomes very high. So this is what happened in 1850 when soldiers were marching on Angus Bridge. Air was still in the night, so the effect of damping was very low, and the soldiers were marching at the natural frequency of the bridge, so resonance occurred. The bridge started to oscillate at a very high amplitude, and hence the bridge collapsed. Hence soldiers are advised to break their march when they pass on a bridge. So that's all I have in this video. Hope you have liked the video. Please do subscribe to my channel. Thank you.